Simon & Schuster Audio presents Use of Force, a Thriller by Brad Thor. Read by Armand Schultz, with an interview with the author. Citius venit malum, quam revertitur. Evil arrives faster than it departs. Italian Coast Guard Headquarters, Maritime Rescue Coordination Center, Rome. An explosion of thunder shook the building as Lieutenant Pietro Renzi, dressed in his navy whites, answered the phone in front of him.
Mayday! Mayday!
A voice said in heavily accented English.
My latitude is N3349.
This was exactly the kind of call Renzi and his team were worried about tonight. North African refugee smugglers were subhuman. Once they had been paid, they put their passengers into unseaworthy boats, tossed in a compass and a satellite phone pre-programmed with the emergency number of the Guardia Costiera, and pointed them toward Italy. Swells as high as 15 meters had already been reported tonight, and the storm was only getting worse.
And beneath that, I need the number beneath.
Please,
the man implored.
I do not have much battery.
Sir, calm down. I need the number beneath.
13.41.
Renzi entered the full coordinates into his computer. 33 degrees, 49 minutes north, 13 degrees, 41 minutes east. The distressed vessel's position appeared on the giant screen at the front of the operations center. The boat was 120 nautical miles from the island of Lampedusa, Italy's southernmost territory.
There is much water inside the boat. We are sinking!
Sir, please. We will send a rescue, but you need to be calm. How many people are on the board?
150 persons. Many women, many children. Please, hurry. We are in danger. We are sinking.
An Italian Coast Guard helicopter was out of the question. They were too far away, and there were too many people. Lieutenant Renzi studied the screen at the head of the room. It showed ships and boats in the central Mediterranean Sea. He searched it for one close enough to help effect a rescue. There was nothing.
Hello! Do you hear me? Please!
The waves are very high.
All the people are sick. We need your help.
Sir, Lieutenant Renzi repeated, trying to reassure the man. We are sending a ship to rescue you, but you must stay calm. How many life jackets do you have?
There was a pause as the man shouted out a question in his language to the people on his boat. When he came back on the line, his response chilled Renzi to the bone.
We have no life jackets.
Burning Man Festival, Black Rock Desert, Nevada. 2 days later. Scot Harvath wasn't supposed to be here. The CIA was forbidden to conduct operations inside the United States, especially the kind he was about to undertake. Desperate times, though, called for desperate measures. The 7-day Burning Man event was an extreme week-long summer solstice festival held on a flat prehistoric lake bed 3 hours outside Reno, Nevada. Outrageous costumes were encouraged, as was tasteful nudity. Costumes ran the gamut from Mad Max to Carnival in Rio. The 5'10" Harvath, with his sandy brown hair and his glacier-like blue eyes, wore a Continental Army coat and a full face of Cherokee war paint, obscuring his handsome features. As the wind kicked up again, he pulled a pair of steampunk goggles over his eyes and wrapped a keffiyeh around his face. Clouds of the fine alkaline dust that covered the playa were swirling everywhere. Visibility was dropping.
50 meters,
a disembodied voice said over the device pushed deep into his left ear.
Burning Man took place in a temporary metropolis built in the Black Rock Desert, which was called Black Rock City. With more than 70,000 attendees, BRC was twice as dense as the City of London. Seen from above, the festival was laid out in the shape of a giant letter C, or two-thirds of a circle. It looked like a blueprint for the Death Star, with a good chunk blown away. It was a mile and a half across, and a quarter mile out from the center of the C was the man, a giant effigy that would be set on fire Saturday night. Burners, as attendees were known, spent months in advance planning elaborately themed camps and villages. Only the ultra-rich showed up on day one, usually via helicopter, to luxury turnkey camps that had already been constructed for them. Almost as controversial as the camps of the ultra-rich was something called Kidsville. It was one of the largest camps at Burning Man and was for families with children, an interesting choice at such an adult festival. Nevertheless, this year, there were about 1,000 kids in attendance.
You should be able to see it now.
Banners and tent flaps blew in the wind. There was a makeshift bar called Seven Deadly Gins, something called Camp Woo Woo, another place called No Bikini Atoll, and an enclave named Toxic Disco Clam. Just beyond was the blue RV. It was dark inside. He tried to peer through several windows, but the blinds were drawn. Pressing his ear against the door, he listened. Nothing. He tried to open the door, but it was locked. Removing a set of picks, within seconds, he had the door unlocked, had affixed the suppressor to his Sig Sauer pistol, and had slipped inside. Even through his keffiyeh, the RV smelled terrible, like stale cigarettes and a toilet that didn't flush well. After he peeled off his goggles, it took a second for his eyes to adjust. Plates of half-eaten food sat on the table. Dishes were stacked in the sink. Hamza Rahim lived like an animal. Noticing something on the floor, Harvath bent over and picked it up. Pieces of electrical wire. His heart rate went up. As far as anyone at the CIA knew, Rahim had been sent to Burning Man for pre-attack surveillance. The wires, though, suggested the CIA's intelligence might have been dangerously off target. Raising his pistol, Harvath crept toward the rear of the vehicle. The first thing he checked was a small closet. It was filled with junk. Across from it was a set of bunk beds, both of which had been slept in. Bad sign. Rahim was supposed to be alone. Beyond the bunk beds was the master area. That bed had also been slept in. There was only one place left to search, the bathroom. The door to it was shut. Locked. Harvath took one hand off his pistol and reached for the door. That was when it exploded. A Middle Eastern-looking man inside the bathroom kicked the door open and threw the contents of a large plastic cup where he thought Harvath would be standing. The highly corrosive cocktail of drain cleaner and household bleach missed Harvath and splattered across the wall and window blinds to his left. Harvath answered the attack by slamming his pistol into the bridge of the man's nose. Immediately, his adversary's knees went weak and began to buckle. Harvath swept in behind him, wrapped his left arm around his throat, and demanded, "Where's Hamza Rahim?" The man struggled, so Harvath pointed his pistol at his left foot and pressed the trigger. The resulting scream was so loud, Harvath had to cover his mouth for fear the man's cries might draw attention.
"Tell me where Rahim is, or I'll shoot the other one."
The man clawed at Harvath. As he did, Harvath noticed that he was missing two fingers on his left hand. This guy was a bomb maker. Harvath now had even more questions, but his eyes, nose, and throat were burning from the poisonous cloud of gas the man had created with his bathroom bleach bomb. They needed to get the hell out of the RV. With his left arm still wrapped tightly around the man's throat, Harvath jabbed the pistol suppressor into his back and pushed him toward the front of the RV. They had only made it halfway when someone appeared at the door.
The figure was dressed in what looked like a monk's robe with a featureless mask made of chrome. The figure also had a weapon, and before Harvath could react, he began to fire. Harvath used the bomb maker as a shield until he had to drop his lifeless body and dive for cover. Shooting out one of the rear windows, he raked the broken glass with his weapon and leapt out, landing hard on the ground. He pulled his goggles back up around his eyes, tightened his keffiyeh, and tried to catch his breath.
"Rahim's not alone,"
Harvath coughed over his radio.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.